Albert Einstein said the significant problems we face cannot be solved at the same level we were at when we created them. I mean, what was he saying? The real problems that we face cannot be solved at the same level we were at when we created them. And I'd never understood that. You know, I heard it said a slightly different way. I heard it said that real solutions will emerge when the questions become more important than the answers. Let me say that again. Real solutions will emerge when the questions become more important than the answers. Okay, great. My name is John Belinsky. I'm honored to be one of the virtual speakers at CAPA this year. And real solutions will emerge when we ask better questions. Okay, so in medicine, you know, the ideal thinking process is to ask really high-end questions so we can get really high-end answers. I'm privileged to talk about the top 10 medical emergencies that you cannot miss. You cannot miss them, first and foremost, because if you do, there's bad outcomes. These are really dangerous diseases that if it happens, there's bad outcomes. And also, you get sued because of them. These are really high lawsuit risk diseases. And as I teach emergency medicine courses, I'm telling you the two major things that I share about getting burned. Like, there's two ways you get burned in medicine. Number one is you see a patient and there's a bad outcome, something you didn't expect. And that just happens, right? The second part of that is if you get sued because of it. Okay, so there's two ways we get sued. Now, first and foremost, we want to practice really good medicine and not miss things. I mean, that's the ideal scenario. But if you do, is your documentation written in a way that prevents you from actually getting served? So our whole talk today is going to be the top 10 medical emergencies that are very high risk and what are some of the documentation pearls to keep you out of trouble. Now, if you get nothing out of this talk today other than this one thing, it would be this. Daniel Kahneman, he wrote a book called Thinking Fast and Slow. Okay. And this was a book on economics about thought. Now, if you question what I'm going to share with you, just understand he won the Nobel Prize for his work. And he said that there are two systems of thinking, system one and system two. System one is our habits. It's lazy. It's energy conserving. It's how we go through the day. You know, when you drive to work, you kind of go on automatic pilot. Your brain just doesn't really think. You know, habits, like you have a hygiene habit and some of us have a fitness habit. You don't have to think about it. You just kind of do it. Now, system two is very different. It's very energy draining. It's like if I said to you, what's 17 times 13? If you try to calculate it, it's very different than jumping in your car and driving to work. Okay. What I'm saying is system two thinking is where the great diagnosis has happened. System one is our habits. Now, what happens in medicine is we're focused on pattern recognition. We look for patterns, right? Like bronchitis, you need 12 pertinent and negatives and positives to diagnose bronchitis. Beautiful, wonderful. Now, what happens when you walk into the room and you've been doing it for a long time and you have system one thinking, you have these habits, you go in the room and you're very casual, doesn't drain you of any energy. But today, this particular bronchitis doesn't have 12 out of 12. It has 11 out of 12. Like, it's pretty close. Seems pretty close, but then you realize they're tachycardic in a way that isn't really explainable, but you kind of, whatever. And then you miss the PE. So what I'm saying is the most important thing is to lower your threshold that when something isn't right to go, this is really interesting. Then you got to go system two thinking. And that means really dissect the issue at a deeper level. Give it a fresh look. Welcome to the top 10 medical emergencies that you cannot miss. Remember, have a low threshold to go to system two thinking. Now, here's what I'm going to ask. We're going to go through 10 pearls, and then at the end, I'm going to ask you to say which one of these was most helpful for you. Which one of these could you apply most to your practice and really use to change how you see patient care and or how you document? So the very first medical emergency you cannot miss is the pulmonary embolism, the pulmonary embolism. PEs are super sneaky. Now, let's talk about some concepts first. You got to understand that there are five causes of chest pain. That's it. There's only five causes of chest pain. Your right hand is your chest pain hand. There's only five causes of chest pain that we have to think about. The mnemonic is, who's your papa? Who's your papa? And there's a dance that goes with it. You go, who's your papa? And you go, there's only five causes of chest pain. Who's your papa? And it goes, pericarditis, acute coronary syndrome. Now, the first two are your heart. That's why you're beating on your heart. The next two are your lungs. pneumothorax or pulmonary embolism. And the last one is your aorta. That's an aortic dissection. Now, if you notice the green writing on the page, those are the diseases that oftentimes present acute and onset. And when I say acute and onset, it means like this, very acute and onset. We're going to come back to that concept coming up. There are five causes of chest pain. Who's your papa? These are the big five you cannot miss. Now, there are also five causes of shortness of breath. Your left hand is your shortness of breath hand. Don't make a horrid mistake. Don't make a horrid mistake. H-O-R-I-D, where H is their heart. It could be congestive heart failure. O is it's an obstructive phenomenon, something blocking airflow. R is reactive airway disease. Is it asthma or COPD? I is infection, bronchitis, pneumonia, COVID, you know, an interstitial pneumonia. And the D is death. Death from a pneumothorax or PE that you didn't think about. There's only five causes of chest pain and five causes of shortness of breath, guys. They all fit under one of these categories. Now, as we're looking at pulmonary embolism, you have to understand the big picture. And this is where understanding the big picture will help us hone into PE. There are three catastrophic blood clots that we have to know in medicine. You have to have mastery of them. You have a heart attack, a stroke, and a PE. They're all blood clots. Now, a little different is heart attack is a thrombus, where a stroke and a PE is an emboli. John, why is that relevant? Because embolis come on like this. You know, what's a stroke? Sudden onset of a neurological deficit came on very abruptly. It's like being shot with a paintball, where a thrombus is like pushing a snowball over a mountain and it gets bigger as it goes. So heart attacks don't come on like that. They come on, you know, I don't feel good. I feel squeezing on my chest. It's a 4 out of 10. Then you come back 30 minutes later. It's like, now it's a 6 out of 10 because the thrombus got bigger. Okay. Now there's big ones and small ones in each category. So we have a big heart attack, STEMI, and we have a small heart attack, non-STEMI. We have a big stroke, CVA, and a small stroke, TIA. Now you have to understand there's big PEs and small PEs. And if you don't understand the difference, you are going to miss the small ones. Because basically, can we agree with this? A big stroke and a little stroke, CVA, TIA, they present exactly the same. Neurological deficits, just the difference is one resolves. And can we agree that STEMI and non-STEMI, they both have chest pain? Like they look really different. Just one's got the traditional EKG findings, right? PE presents so radically different that if you don't know the differences, you get burned. It's kind of like beta blockers, right? There's four beta blockers. They all have very similar side effect profiles, cardiac specific, non-cardiac specific, this ISA beta blocker, you know, beta blocker, alpha blocker. Yeah, they all have all of them. You got to avoid an asthma, right? They all have potential for bronchospasm. But then you have the calcium channel blockers. They're so radically different, you really can't even believe they're in the same class, right? And the name of the class is that what typically throws us off. So if you think of it this way, you have two waters and not two waters, like dihydropyridines, which is two waters, dihydro and non-dihydro. Now, dihydropyridines, they dilate. They're just like nitroglycerin. Dihydros dilate. They all end in the six letters dipine. So dipine, amlodipine, nifedipine. Dihydros dilate, where non-dihydropyridines like diltiazem and verapamil, they slow down the heart. So can I use a calcium channel blocker in some of the heart rate of 56? Sure, you can use a dihydropyridine, but you can't use a non-dihydro. I'm saying that because calcium channel blockers are so radically different that I'm surprised they're in the same class. And that's the same thing with PE. The big ones and small ones present so differently that if you don't have the mindset to understand how different they present, you're going to miss the small ones. Now, before we talk about the difference between big one and small, we have to understand risk factors. Now, risk factors drive our thinking. It's a really big deal, okay? If I said to you a 56-year-old male came into the ER with chest pain over 1 hour, what are the chances of having a heart attack? Now, you might come up with a number in your head. Let's say you say 30%, and there's no right or wrong answer there, but then I tell you he's a diabetic smoker. Your number goes up, okay? It has to. Risk factors drive what we do. Now, the risk factors for pulmonary embolism is Virchow's triad, or I'd suggest you go like this. Pretend you're carrying a dish. So it's D, S, H. So Virchow's triad is dish, damage to an extremity, typically broken bones, stasis speaks for itself, prolonged plane ride, train rides, or mobilization, an HS hypercoagulable state, people whose blood is excessively clotty. And it really falls under just three things: high estrogen states, pregnancy, birth control pills, cancer, or genetics. And there's a bunch of genetic problems. So I always want to ask, hey, has anybody in your family ever had a blood clot in their leg or in their lung and they were put on blood thinners for it? Okay. So these are your venous risk factors. The tool that I'd like to suggest to you is the PERC rules, the pulmonary embolism rule out criteria. I feel they're way better than the Wells criteria. There are five things you want to look for the PERC criteria. And there's a dance, and the dance goes like this. It goes, five things. V, V, So V, this V stands for Virchow's triad. This V stands for, you better look at their vital signs. This over here suggests for hemoptysis. That's got to be pertinent negative. About 10% of PEs cough up blood. Now over here is an age range, meaning that the person's got to be less than the age of 50 if you want to apply the PERC rules. Now, if they're over 50, the PERC rules are still helpful, but you really can't document no PERC and PERC negative because the rules, like I'm 54, you can't use the PERC rules on me. According to the American College of Emergency Physicians, if you have a low-risk patient, you can use the PERC rules, but you got to use the D-dimer with it. If they have a negative dimer, a negative PERC, there's no PE. And lastly, you got to do a leg exam. Go, do they possibly have DVT, Homansign cord, thickness, fullness, asymmetry of the calves? So the PERC rules, VV, vital signs you're looking for, are they tachycardic or hypoxic? You're looking for Virchow's triad, as we discussed before. No hemoptysis, they got to be age 50 or less. And then they can't have an abnormal leg exam. So guys, one of the major pearls is anytime you have someone shortness of breath, you better do a leg exam. You better do a leg exam. Okay. Like if you have some bronchitis, asthma, COPD, and you need to do a leg exam, you're going to get burned. Okay. Why are you doing a leg exam? Because when you look at the Horde mnemonic, two out of the five of those have leg exams. CHF can have leg swelling, and DVT is obviously something you can find with a pulmonary embolism. Now, when it comes to the American College of Emergency Physicians, they say, if you have a low-risk patient, if you have a low-risk patient and they're PERC negative, you can document in your chart PERC negative and your workup is done. You don't need to do dimers, VQs, or CAT scans, okay? Now, here's the kicker. Please listen very closely to what I'm going to say here. When someone's got a big PE, it goes through their central circulation, hits them, and they get a saddle PE. Now, when you have a big PE, nobody misses these. They're really short of breath. They have abnormal vital signs. They look sick. Nobody misses big ones. Here's the kicker. The lung has no nerve tissue in it, so they have no chest pain, but they're very short of breath. So a big PE, sudden onset, very short of breath with abnormal vital signs. Now a small PE goes through the heart, lodges itself in the periphery of the lung. Only 2 or 3% of the lung function has been diminished. So therefore, they'll have normal vital signs. So a small PE, they have normal vitals, guys. So the mantra I have heard and teach is, what is the most common abnormal vital sign with a PE? And it's normal vital signs. When someone has a small PE, their vital signs are completely normal. Here's what you need to know. Listen, when you have an inflamed segment of lung from a small PE, does it hurt? No, because the lung has no nerve tissue in it. I told you that. Here is the pleura. The pleura is the side of the chest wall that's a hotbed of nerves. Whenever something inflamed touches it, it's very painful. It's kind of like a Murphy sign, but in the lung. That's when a patient breathes. So if a patient breathes like this, they have very shallow breathing, there's no pain. But as soon as they take a deep breath, the pain is agonizing. It's like you get jabbed with a metal spike. And it's purely pleuritic, which means it only hurts when they breathe. If they take shallow breaths, the pain is 0 out of 10. Like if I fall and break my ribs, my chest wall will hurt irregardless of breathing. So if I broken ribs and you say, how bad is your pain? I'd go, it's like a 4 out of 10. How about when you breathe? Oh, it's worse when I breathe. It's an 8 out of 10. So chest wall pathology is worse when I breathe. PE is only when I breathe. That's the caveat. You have to document purely pleuritic chest pain. And guys, it's very easy. When you put your stethoscope on someone's chest, they take a breath, they breathe in and out. If they have no pain, you can document no pleuritic chest pain. So the three things that are very important to document is Virchow's triad, no pleuritic chest pain, and a leg exam. Those are the three things that are key to diagnose to not get burned. Now, what are the symptoms of a PE, John? Shortness of breath is the primary symptom people complain of, 73%. Pleuritic chest pain is about two-thirds, 66%. Leg complaints, about 45%, 44%. Cough is about a third, and then wheezing is about 1 out of 5 or 20%. These are what they complain of. But if you look here, you have shortness of breath, cough, and wheezing. Those are all pulmonary symptoms, okay? They have pulmonary symptoms, shortness of breath, and pleuritic chest pain, possibly leg complaints. Now, what are the signs? Tachypnea, they'll be breathing fast over 50% of the time. They'll have an increased respiratory rate. Leg findings, about 50%. You better do a leg exam. Tachycardia is only 24%. Come on, I thought it was going to be higher than that. Not with the small ones. And guys, you're going to see way more small ones because they're more common. Big ones die. Rales, 18%, and then even fever, 3%. Some PEs can present with fever. Please remember, three most important things to document. No pleuritic chest pain, Virchow's triad, and a leg exam. Next, acute coronary syndromes. Acute coronary syndromes. Guys, this is really a big deal. You got to really know how to address acute coronary syndrome and how not to get burned by them. There are three acute coronary syndromes. So when I see ACS, there's three diseases. Like if I say MI, there's two diseases, STEMI, non-STEMI. Acute coronary syndrome is STEMI, non-STEMI, unstable angina. Now a STEMI, I can tell a STEMI in about 15 seconds from the EKG. They'll have ST segment elevation, two contiguous leads with depressions and two contiguous leads and or a left bundle branch block. So STEMI is an EKG diagnosis, non-STEMI is a troponin diagnosis. Now, according to the World Health Organization, you need 2 out of 3 things to say someone has had an MI. You need number 1, anginal symptoms, number 1. Number 2, abnormal EKG. Number 3, positive biomarkers. So you need 2 out of 3 of those. So if someone comes in with chest pain and an abnormal EKG, 2 out of 3. If someone has chest pain, a normal EKG, positive biomarkers, troponin. You have a STEMI. Now, the World Health Organization did change your recommendations over time to say you need a rise and fall of biomarkers, saying that some people have positive troponins all the time because of their BUN creatinine. But understand that STEMI and non-STEMI will indeed ultimately have positive troponins, but unstable angina does not. Now, ultimately, we rule out unstable angina by a stress test. If you don't have a stress test, unstable angina is still possible. So here's the question. What aspects of chest pain are very important that we identify? What are the risk factors that we need to use to weigh in before we send them home? Now, let me give you a caveat. First and foremost, anybody who's got any objective findings like EKG changes or even a mildly positive troponin, I highly discourage them going home, even though the rule set will speak differently to that. You know, as an advanced practitioner, if I get any objective findings, there is no way I would send them home. No way. I'd either consult a physician and they can take the burden of that responsibility, or I would admit them to the hospital. Now, the tool is the HEART score. The HEART score, oh, this is a great scoring system, guys. Basically, the HEART score is 5 things you look at. They get a score anywhere from 0 to 10. Okay. So the highest HEART score is a 10, lowest is a 0. Now, the only thing we're talking about is what HEART score can be useful to send the patient home. And that HEART score is between 0 and 3. Anybody over 3, they're getting admitted to the hospital. So John, what are the 5 components of HEART score? The beauty is that's a mnemonic, HEART. H is history. Is history not suspicious, mildly, moderately suspicious, or highly suspicious? So John, what part of the history makes it suspicious or not? Well, there are 4 major things we look for. Number 1 is when you look at the likelihood ratios of people ruling in, we look at radiation. Is there any radiation either to the right arm, left arm, or both? Did the pain present with exertion? Okay, that would increase the likelihood ratio of ruling in. Was there diaphoresis or was there nausea and vomiting? So those are the big 4. So I want to drive home an important part of the history. I want to drive home, what's the red flags? What are the red flags of the history? I want to drive this home to you. Well, drive is the mnemonic. Did they have diaphoresis with their chain? Beaded up sweat. Was there radiation? The I is just a filler letter, doesn't really stand for anything. V is vomiting, E is exertion. So drive, those are the things that lead to a sinister history that would make me less likely to send them home, more concerned about them. E is their EKG. You really have to know how to read a 12-lead EKG, okay? Now at Kappa, if you're not familiar with Jen Carlquist and her EKG tutorial programs or educational programs, she's the best speaker I've ever heard. She's absolutely extraordinary. I'd encourage you to look into her work. At Senior for Life, we also have an EKG program called the Black Belt EKG program. I believe will raise your knowledge to a very high level. Understand though, it's your responsibility to find a teaching system that really works for you. There's lots of ways to learn EKGs. You have to figure out the best learning system for you. A is age, speaks for itself. I'm 54, therefore I automatically have a heart score of 1. R is risk factors. So we have to look at the risk factors. Now, there was venous risk factors, but there's also arterial risk factors. So when I say arterial risk factors, I go like that and go, ooh, that's a sad case of CHF. There's 6 things we look for. The mnemonic is sad CHF. Now, when you look at where were the risk factors even identified, they looked at over 500,000 patients presenting with their very first MI, and 86% of them had one of the major risk factors. So sad CHF is smoking, age, diabetes, cholesterol, hypertension, family history. Now, just be aware, guys. It's not like they get, you know, 0 to 6 points. Qualify them a little bit. Someone who has a hemoglobin A1C of 12 is different than someone with a hemoglobin A1C of 7. You know, someone with uncontrolled hypertension is different than someone who's controlled. So just know that the more we know about the risk factors, the more it stacks the deck, and be very, very careful about 2 people in this world. Number one is young ladies on birth control pills who present with pulmonary pathology, like asthma, COPD. Make sure it's not a P. Be very careful about diabetics. Diabetics love to burn us. They love to burn us. They love to come in with really weird presentations. And as I've preached this at my urgent care and emergency medicine courses, after a course the 1 year, I got an email from an attendee that said this right after the course. I have a sad story for you. One of our patients, a 50-year-old diabetic male, went to the ER and said he had a toothache. He was given antibiotics at home. He returned to the ER in cardiac arrest and died. Guys, his toothache was unstable angina. It wasn't really dental pain. You're right, meaning they present atypically. I feel for the ER provider. I may have done the same thing. I just want to let you know. And if you're looking at this going, John, how could I possibly not have got burned by this? Well, first off, you have to understand that diabetics are sneaky. And if a diabetic comes in and says, my tooth hurt, and you look in at the tooth and the teeth look completely stone cold normal, you better go, that's not normal. Why would a diabetic have tooth pain? Why would anybody have tooth pain but a completely normal looking tooth? If it's a diabetic, an EKG may be warranted. Have a low threshold to do EKGs on diabetics. And the T is troponin, meaning that if the troponin is a little bit positive at 1 point, even a moderate positive at 2 points, but please understand something, guys. When you look at the E and the T, those are objective findings. If they have any abnormal EKG findings or troponin findings, do not apply this rule. Not as an advanced practitioner. Docs can do whatever they want to. So we're going to look at their history, their age, and their risk factors. Now, when you look at the heart score, they found if your score was 3 or less, your chance of a major adverse coronary event in the next 6 weeks was less than 2%. Anything above 3, the risk was absolutely unacceptable. So the only time we're talking about sending someone home and applying the heart score is if it's less than 3. Now, they found that at 6 weeks, the chance of an adverse event was less than 2%. But if you watch them for 3 hours and did a second troponin, that drops to less than 1%. That's very acceptable. So the only time we're sending someone home with chest pain would be if their heart score is 3 or less. And that would be an acceptable thing to document. You have shared decision-making, talk to the patient. And then some people even use this graph where they say, hey, the chances are not zero that you will have something bad happen in the next 6 weeks, but here are the odds. If you throw a dart at this and it hits one of the hearts, if we hit the black one, then you have something bad happen. Would you like to go home and be worked up as an outpatient? So it's a very reasonable approach. So as we talked about PE and acute coronary syndrome, I would encourage you documenting this on every chart. Anybody with chest pain or shortness of breath, document their arterial risk factors, document their venous risk factors, and a normal leg exam. Now, if you really want to stay out of trouble with PE, pleuritic chest pain, use that as a pertinent negative. Next, we have hyperkalemia. When I say electrolyte emergency, there's really only one electrolyte emergency. It's hyperkalemia. This is going to be 97% of all the electrolyte emergencies that we see. Now, you have to understand that a normal potassium is 3.5 to 5.5, okay? And if I said to you, What's the number one cause of hyperkalemia? The answer is it's a lab error. It's always a lab error till proven otherwise. You have to think that way or you're going to get burned. So whenever you get an elevated potassium, always redraw it, assume it's a hemolyzed specimen, because you're going to have to address it. You don't want to be chasing ghosts. You don't want to be trying to intervene on something that is not even legitimate. So the number one step with anybody who's hyperkalemic is to do a redraw. Now, what patients are always hyperkalemic? Dialysis patients. So here's what I would submit to you to consider to stay out of trouble with dialysis patients. All dialysis patients are three things. Always hyperkalemic, acidic, their blood's acid, and fluid overloaded. All dialysis patients are three things, but it's relatively always. What do you mean by relatively always? It means it's relative to their last dialysis, okay? So you always have to tell me when was their last dialysis. Don't ever call and say, hey, John, I got a dialysis patient I'm sending you, because I'm going to be like, if they were dialyzed yesterday, their potassium's fine. But if you say that they were dialyzed 5 days ago, I'm going to say, I better do an EKG. So the two initial things you have to know about hyperkalemia is, number one, it's always a lab error to prove it otherwise. And number two, hyperkalemia, the risk is always relative to the last dialysis. So when someone comes in, they're hyperkalemic, how do I know how risky they are? Their EKG, you got to do a stat EKG. Now with an EKG, there are three things we look for. Picture taking a PEQ ST wave and bending it out of a coat hanger and putting the ends of the coat hanger into two clamps. You grab a pair of pliers and start pulling up on the T wave, and then three things are going to happen. Number one, you're going to have peaked T waves. That's phase one hyperkalemia. As you keep pulling up, the QRS complex is going to widen out. And then as you keep pulling up, the P wave is going to flatten. So there are three changes in hyperkalemia: peaked Ts, wide complex QRSs, and flat P waves. And they go in that progression. Now, if you look at this, this is an EKG of a patient who's 5 days out from dialysis. Look at those symmetrically peaked T waves. Here's someone who's a little bit sicker, peaked Ts, wide complex QRSs. And here's someone with flat P waves. They're just about to code. If you have no EKG changes, wait for the labs to come back. If there's EKG changes, this is an emergency. You should not leave its bedside. And just know that the interventions to treat the patient are very safe and very benign. I like to tell my emergency medicine audiences that if I gave you Narcan right now, how much would it affect you? Well, it shouldn't affect you at all if you don't have opiates on board. Same thing with hyperkalemia. If I treat you with hyperkalemia, but you don't need it, like you're not hyperkalemic, the meds are super safe. Now, how do we treat hyperkalemia? Three categories. We stabilize the membranes with calcium. We shift potassium into the cell, a couple different modalities, and we work to get it out of the body. Now, we stabilize the membranes with calcium, calcium chloride or calcium gluconate, whatever you got. It'll buy you about 30 to 45 minutes where the patient won't code on you. So anybody with EKG changes, give them calcium. Is there any controversy there, John? A little bit. If you read up to date, they'll talk about, some people suggest you don't need calcium if it's just phase one, peak T waves. There are people 1,000 times smarter than me who suggest calcium is very safe. And even if they have peak T waves, give it to them. And that's what I do. You know, if they're on digoxin, I would encourage you to pause and ask some questions. But other than that, calcium overall is pretty safe. Now, how do we shift potassium in the cell? Now, before we explain that, let's just look at a couple different mechanisms, how the body works. Now, anybody's in metabolic acidosis, that red cylinder is your blood vessel. The purple is your cell. Anybody in a metabolic acidosis, the body will suck hydrogen into the cell and spit potassium out. So anybody who's in a metabolic acidosis, they're going to be hyperkalemic. Now, if you understand that, the opposite logic is also true. So if I put someone into a metabolic alkalosis by giving them bicarb, the opposite happens. So if I give someone bicarb, I will drive potassium in the cell. Now, the second thing you have to understand is anybody who's hyperglycemic, potassium will follow glucose. So if someone's hyperglycemic, we just have to treat them. Now, John, what if they're not hyperglycemic? Like, what if they're not a diabetic? Well, let's transiently make them one. Let's give them an amp of dextrose and then fix them. So if I give a hyperglycemic insulin, it will drive glucose in the cell and suck potassium with it. I can drive potassium in the cell by giving them sodium bicarb or giving them dextrose and then insulin. So I can drive potassium in the cell with sodium bicarb, insulin, dextrose, or high-dose Preventil. high dose Promethah. Oh, how does that work, John? I don't fully understand the mechanism. And oh, it's a pearl. It's a pearl. Okay, well, what are the pearls? Well, first off, when someone comes in and they're hyperkalemic, at least you are suspicious of it based on their EKG and their risk factors of missing dialysis, a lot of times it's tough to get an IV. Throw 4 Promethah nebs on them. It's super safe and you don't need IV access. The second pearl is this. If you understand the mechanism that potassium will go where glucose goes, if you give a patient dextrose IV, it'll translate, make their blood hyperosmotic, and therefore potassium will actually go up a little bit before the insulin kicks in. There have been case reports of people going into cardiac arrest right after the dextrose was infused. So I never start there. Those are the pearls. Now, how do you get potassium out of the body? Well, dialysis is ultimately what we do, dialysis. But understand K-oxalate or some kind of resin binder in the gut, either PO or PR, will take it out. And then just know loops. You know, we don't use loops if a patient's hyperkalemic, just as more of an intellectual understanding. Remember, furosemide will lower potassium, but we don't use it therapeutically. Now, if you look at the blue box, you understand that, you know, we rarely use just one. We normally, like if I'm going to give someone calcium chloride for hyperkalemia, they're going to get bicarb, insulin dextrose, K-oxalate, and then I'm going to talk to nephrology about dialyzing them. So next is a subarachnoid hemorrhage. I got to confess, you know, the first few subarachnoids I saw clinically, I'm like, oh, they all had meningism. They all had a stiff neck, similar to meningitis. And I'm thinking, oh, subarachnoids have stiff necks. And then when I worked at a regional stroke center, I realized there are lots of people who do not. It's all relative to how much blood is in your cerebrospinal fluid. Please be aware that there are 5 classes of subarachnoid based on the Hunt and Hess scale. In class 1 and class 2 of the Hunt and Hess, they have headaches, but they don't have any neurological findings. So be very careful. Now, what's the key of a subarachnoid hemorrhage to not be missed? Well, first off, it's acute onset. That's it. The headaches come on like this. Migraines don't do that. Clusters don't do that. Tensions don't do this. This is acute onset of headache. Now, be very careful about something. You'll have people with migraines and you say, oh, did it come on gradual acute? And they say acute and you type in acute. You put it in your chart and you say, well, what do you mean by acute? And they said, oh, it came on over like 3 hours. Okay, that's not acute. That's gradual over 3 hours. So subarachnoids often have nausea, vomiting. And guys, whenever you have increased intracranial pressure, the body will try to compensate for that. The body will say, holy cow, there's too much pressure here. I got to get rid of pressure. So the patient will vomit. That's the body trying to compensate for the increased intracranial pressure. Anybody with head injury or headache with persistent vomiting, you better scan them. And it's the same thing with the eye. If you have someone with eye pain and they keep vomiting, that's acute angle closure glaucoma. That's a body saying, oh crap, I got to get rid of fluid. Neck pain, depending on how much blood's there. Possibly syncope. No, 19 out of 20 are fine on a CAT scan, but that means 1 out of 20 are not. And if you have someone with a suspicious story, a negative CAT scan does not rule them out. You better do a lumbar puncture or facilitate getting one done where you're looking for either blood or xanthochromia. Now, don't be fooled by a low-grade temperature. Sometimes subarachnoids can have temperature. The biggest thing you need to know here, guys, is when it comes to headaches, you have to tell me, is it acute or gradual? Acute onset is a subarachnoid till proven otherwise. Now, John, what are the other diseases that come on acutely? I have mnemonics for everything. When I teach board review, PANTS, PANRI, emergency medicine, it is all about how do I give you information that really sticks deeply. A beast. Beast is the mnemonic for acute onset. Beast comes on acutely. So if you read a question that says sudden onset, it's on this mnemonic. So beast stands for something bursts. Now, John, what bursts? Aneurysms, ovarian cysts, lungs, spontaneous pneumothoraces, peptic ulcer disease, atopic pregnancies. These are the kind of things that burst. E is emboli, like AFib shoots off emboli. Pulmonary embolism, they come on acutely. Arrhythmias. Understand that when someone passes out, oftentimes it's like vasovagal orthostatic, but something happened right before they passed out. When it's cardiogenic, they're out really fast. S is stones. Gallstones, kidney stones typically come on pretty acutely. Now, when it comes to kidney stones, I have a mnemonic. I get mnemonics for everything, right? Oh, say, can you see? Oh, say, can you see? O-S-C-U, the letter C, O-struvite, calcium, uric acid, and cysteine. Those are your 4 kidney stones. And then the T is telescoping or twisting, meaning intussusception. It could be torsion of the ovary or the testicles. Next, sepsis. Ooh, guys, sepsis can be very sneaky. Early sepsis, you cannot miss. Now, the SIRS criteria is not a good criteria, guys. I mean, it's good for billing. It's good to getting people admitted and get paid, but it's not a good decision tool. I'd like to share with you a tool that I find very helpful. Now, before we do that, understand that you got to get a valid temp, and that means rectal temps in kids and geriatrics. Now, when it comes to basic labs, with a CBC, you want the absolute count, neutrophil, and bands. It's better to give me three numbers. Hey, John, I got 18,000 white count, 92% neutrophils, 14 bands. Remember, bands are immature whites, immature neutrophils. And when you have double-digit bands, when you have a high band count, that is called a left shift, and that's as sinister as a positive troponin. You need blood cultures. You always want to look at the major body compartments. Now, when someone's septic, you want to look at wind and water first. Are they uroseptic or do they have pneumonia? Then brain and belly. Okay, do they have meningitis? Do they have Koenig sign or Brzezinski sign? Do they have any abnormal findings in the belly? Okay, guarding rigid rebound. So the five major compartments that you're looking for sepsis is wind and water, brain and belly, and then skin. Make sure you're not missing a cellulitis or decubitus ulcer. And if it's not one of those five, I mean, you better be go on an investigation. Like, could this be endocarditis? Now, just understand something. The most sensitive way to monitor for shock is urine output. That is the most sensitive way. And that means you put a Foley catheter in someone, you throw the urine that you had just removed from the bladder out, and then you watch how much urine are they making per hour. So the average adult should make half a cc per kilo per hour. So I'm a 100 kilo guy. I should be making 50 cc's every single hour. And if I am, I'm perfusing my body wonderfully. I am not septic. So every 2 hours, an adult should put out between 70 and 100 cc's. Kids are twice that much. When that urine output drops below that amount, they are not perfusing their body. And when they're not perfusing their body, they go into anaerobic metabolism. When they go into anaerobic metabolism, they produce lactic acid. So the lactic acid will be directly correlated with the decreased urine output. And when they go into lactic acid, they're going to metabolic acidosis. They Kussmaul breathe. So the respiratory rate goes up. So like I call the septic triad, John's septic triad. This is not in the literature. This is just what I teach at my courses, is that the lower urine output goes, two things go up, lactic acid and respiratory rate. There is the SIRS criteria, which I'm saying is not a good decision tool. There is what's called the SOFA score, which is good if you're in the ICU, not really relevant to PAs. I'd like to suggest you the quick SOFA score. This is sexy. It's very usable. It's the killer Bs, three Bs, brain, breathing, blood pressure. So it's brain, breathing, blood pressure. If they got a fever plus two out of three of those, the concern for sepsis should be quite high. That's called the quick SOFA score, looking for two out of three things. Anybody's got a fever, altered mental status, and hypotension, they're septic. Altered mental status, breathing at 26, septic. Normal breathing, normal mentation, but they're breathing high and they're hypotensive, septic. Two large bore IVs, IV fluids, antibiotics, get a consultant in board ASAP. Next is appendicitis. Now, appendicitis is the great masquerader. Appendicitis is one of the highest reasons we get sued in medicine. It's always in the top three lists, no matter what you look for. Appendicitis is very sneaky. You get a blocked appendix, typically with a fecal lith, and the whole belly shuts down. Here's what you need to know. For the first 8 hours, appendicitis is not diagnosable. It looks exactly like gastroenteritis, non-focal belly pain, malaise, low-grade fever, nausea, vomiting. For the first 8 hours, appendicitis looks like gastroenteritis. Nobody can diagnose it. You have to understand that. Now, when you look at discharge diagnoses of missed appendicitis, it's gastroenteritis. Now, the first pearl is never diagnose someone with a benign self-limiting problem. Don't diagnose anybody with meningitis. Or hold on. You can diagnose meningitis, but don't diagnose people with gastroenteritis, because that's a benign self-limiting problem. It's like costochondritis. That's benign self-limiting. If you diagnose someone with gastroenteritis and they go home and have a perfed appy, that's difficult to explain to a jury member. Hey, you just said they had a benign self-limiting problem, then they had a perfed appy. Call it abdominal pain. And then in your note put, it's probable gastroenteritis, but appendicitis has not been ruled out, and this has been discussed with the patient. So how do you not get burned by appendicitis? And the answer is, the appendix can be very sneaky, guys. When it's blocked, it's nonspecific for the first third of the disease, which they normally present then. It looks like just a stomach flu. The best test to diagnose and never miss appendicitis is time. Just give it enough time. Appendicitis will evolve and become very crystal clear. So what does that mean? Anybody with gastroenteritis, you've got to tell the patient, hey, this looks like just a stomach flu. It looks like your stomach's irritated. I would say 97 out of 100 people are going to get better in 24 hours. 3% are going to have an early appendicitis. You will know because you'll get worse. The pain will radiate down to McBurney's point. And if it happens, you got to come in. CAT scans early in the process aren't even really helpful. Just have a really good physical exam. So what is the mnemonic for the four things we look for appendicitis? The mnemonic is PROM, P-R-O-M, P-R-O-M, P is psoas sign. If you lift up the leg, does the psoas muscle push into the retrocecal appendix? A little bit silly. Rob Singh is if you push left lower quadrant, hurt right lower quadrant. Now, John, how does that even work? Doesn't make sense. Well, it does. If you push down the left lower quadrant, you'll push up on the right lower quadrant like a teeter-totter, and it will push the appendix into the peritoneum. Obturator sign is if you roll the leg out, push the obturator muscle into the appendix. And then McBurney's point is the location. Those are your four buzzwords to document so you don't get burned by appendicitis. But also remember, just talk to the patient and say, hey, listen, you know, the chances of being appendicitis are very low, but it's possible. And you will know because the pain will get worse and it'll get focal down here. You put that in your note. You put it in the discharge instruction. Say, appendicitis was discussed. If things get worse or change, come back. Now, the diagnostic test of choice is going to be a contrasted CAT scan with PO and IV contrast. And you scan who needs to be scanned, but you can't scan every gastroenteritis, guys. That's not responsible. Okay, so just document it. Have shared decision-making, but put in your note and discharge instructions that appendicitis was discussed. And always write down, as discussed, appendicitis is possible. Return of things get worse or change. So if you send them home and they come back, you're not negligent. You're not negligent. You just made a choice. Easily defendable. So appendicitis, just know that the psoas sign, Rob Singh, obturator, McBurney, there's some literature behind it. None of those are great. You know, you really want to look for the radiation of the pain where it starts, it moves and migrates from diffuse to right lower quadrant. But overall, these are the things to document to tell the world that you thought about appendicitis. Next, a sick kid, a sick kid. Now, kid comes in to see you. You need to basically ask, is this basically a kid who's got a fever and has got, you know, a self-limiting problem, or is there a life-threatening problem here? What's it between a kid with otitis media and a kid with meningitis? That's what's important. And the answer is you got to tickles them. These are the key things you need to document on your chart and look for to determine a poopy kid, a listless kid versus a lethargic kid. Now, when a kid's poopy looking, either from fever or dehydration, we call them listless. Lethargic implies they need a lumbar puncture and they're very, very sick. So don't use the term lethargic unless you mean a kid who you really think is going to die. So you tickles them. T stands for their tone. Do they have a strong tone or a wimpy tone? Are they pushing your stethoscope away and otoscope away? So document it. I and C go together, irritability, consolability. Are they appropriately irritated by provoking examiner, consolable by parent? K is cry, loud and vigorous or wimpy. L is labor. You better take off their shirt. Do they have mild, moderate, or severe respiratory distress? E is environment. Are they appropriately stimulated by the environment? And if you don't have kids, that can be tricky. That can be tricky because you don't know the milestones. And the S is suckling, meaning what's their eating and drinking history been? Typically, septic kids won't take in anything, but kids with otitis media, I mean, they won't eat solids very well, but their liquid intake will be sustainable to life. Please remember something, guys, acetaminophen and ibuprofen, they do lower temperatures. Wonderful. Now, what's the benefit of that? What is the benefit of lowering temperatures? Does that have any kind of diagnostic value? The answer is no. I mean, kids, when you lower their temperature, they feel better, but it doesn't mean that they're less sick or more sick. You know, you can have someone with meningitis, acetaminophen or ibuprofen will still drop their temperature. They're still really sick. You can have people with like roseola that can have really high temperatures and it's a little more stubborn to antipyretics. So understand the deprivescence of fever has no therapeutic or no diagnostic, you know, leverage. Doesn't help us diagnose things. Next, epiglottitis. So you know that you have two throat infections that we got to be concerned about, croup and epiglottitis. If I push right here in my throat, I'm giving myself croup. If you do an x-ray, you'll see steeple sign. Now, With epiglottitis, the appendix looks like a thick fingernail. Now it gets infected, it swells up like the size of a thumb or a sausage, but it's really floppy, meaning if a person leans forward, the epiglottis falls forward and they lose their airway. If they lean back, it flops back and they lose their airway. Now, if you've ever seen a seal at a circus, a seal at a circus will balance something on their nose like this. So if you see a patient who's sitting like this, they're not balancing something on the nose, they're balancing their epiglottis in the upright position. Guys, you got to look at patient position when you walk in the room. If you walk in the room and the patient turns to look at you like this, you better go, why aren't they moving their neck? If they have a fever, that's very concerning. If someone has a sore throat, like this, that's epiglottitis. I mean, they're typically sick. They'll be in the tripod position, fever, stridor, high-pitched voice, drooling. It's normally from a germ, staph, strep, or H flu. We start an IV. We give them antibiotics. So on a lateral x-ray, we're going to look for this thumbprint sign, where you look at the soft tissue. Do you see a nub? Do you see a nub that looks like a thumbprint? If you look at this image, look at the cervical spine, how it's projecting the head forward. Now, if you look at the image that's on your right, that's a normal cervical spine, okay? The cervical spine is well-rounded. There's no focal deficits as opposed to on the left, where the cervical spine is much more linear, and you can see that big thumbprint. But the thing is, guys, that person will be leaning forward. So patient position is the key to not missing epiglottitis. Next, we have suicidal ideations. Anybody who comes in with any kind of depression, anxiety, anything that has a psychiatric component to it, you need to rule them out for suicidal or homicidal ideations. Now, very, very generally in your note, just put down no SI, no HI, no suicidations, no homicidal ideations. That's the bare minimum. Now, Johnny, you said like with arterial disease, there are arterial risk factors. Yeah, SAD, CHF, smoking, age, diabetes, cholesterol, hypertension, family. You said, John, with PEDBT, there's venous risk factors. Yes. DISH, damage, stasis, hypercoagulable state. John, you said with hyperkalemia, there's risk factors. Yeah. When was the dialysis patient's last dialysis? Now, there are risk factors that we look for to see who is higher risk for committing suicide. Now, the mnemonic is SAD persons. SAD persons. S stands for sex. Males are more likely to commit suicide. Women attempt it more. Men do it more. A is age. There's a bimodal distribution of young and old, teenagers and geriatrics. D is depression, a history of depression. P is, did they have a past attempt? Have they tried to hurt themselves in the past? E is ETOH or substance abuse. R is rational thought loss. That's just a creative way of saying schizophrenia. Have they lost touch of reality? Social support's lacking. They're homeless. O is an organized plan, which we're going to talk about in a second. N is no spouse, recently divorced. And then the S is sickness. Did they have a diagnosis of some terminal problem like, or major life-threatening problem like cancer? So these are the risk factors. Now, organized plan is a really big one, guys. When you're assessing someone, you say, hey, have you ever thought of hurting yourself? And they say, well, I've thought about it. Now, I don't necessarily believe that that is pathologic. I think that that's metaphysical. Like we've all had bad times in our lives. Here's where things become helpful is when you say, if you're going to kill yourself, how would you do it? Now, if someone says like, cause you know, I did a lot of my practice in Buffalo, New York, right by Niagara Falls. And if someone went like, I think I'd jump into Niagara Falls. Okay. Well, that's one thing. It's another thing. If someone says, if I said, if you're going to hurt yourself, how'd you do it? And they said, I would take my box cutter home from work and slit my throat. Okay. I had a patient say that to me. I was like, okay, wow, that was pretty quick. And the person's mom was in the room and the mom started crying. And all of a sudden he'd thought about this for a long time. That's a very organized plan. Now coming through one of our Panery review courses, I had a lady whose sister ran the suicide hotline for Chicago. And she said, one of the triggers to have the people on the hotline immediately call the ambulance or 911 is the organized plan. If they had an organized plan, that was very concerning. They would call for help. Anhedonia. So be aware of that. Ask, hey, what do you do for joy? What's fun in your life? When someone says they have no joy or perception of joy, ever having joy again, that would be concerning. And then do they have access to a firearm? Know that people who say, If I committed suicide, it'd be through a firearm, and they have access to one, that puts them in a very high risk pool. Next or last is the sick eye. The sick eye. Now, I think eyes are super hard, guys. I think there's a lot of eye problems that are really bad, and I don't know how to manage. Okay, well, ophthalmology does. Obviously, ophthalmology is super friendly when we call them. Okay, now, if anybody out there has any eye pun jokes, if you have any eye pun, please send them to me, because I love eye pun jokes, and the cornier the better. The cornier the better. Okay, that's horrible. Now, bottom line is, I can't miss a sick eye. You can't miss a sick eye, uveitis, retinitis, acute angle closure, glaucoma. You can't miss these things. So there are two things that you have to look for and document so you do not miss a sick eye. Number one is visual acuity is the eye, what an EKG is to the heart, which basically means that when you get so good at taking care of chest pain, you can do it without an EKG. Then you can take care of eye complaints without doing visual acuity. So what am I saying? You can never, ever, ever take care of eye complaints without visual acuity. You have to document it. And I don't care what you document. What if they don't have their glass, they can't see the E? Well, you better document that. Can they document fingers at 4 or 5 feet? Better document that. What if they can't even see that? Can they tell if it's light or dark? You better document visual acuity in one way, shape, or form. That's the first part of this. Second part is, how is the limbus? The limbus. Well, John, what's the limbus? The limbus is around the iris. There should be about a 1 centimeter area of the eye that's clear. So if I look here from 7 o'clock until 11 o'clock, the limbus is clear, and we would document limbus is clear. Now, when that limbus is clear in a circumiral trajectory all around the eye, it's a benign eye. It's superficial. Now, if you look at this image here, I'm using this as an example to say, hey, the limbus is clear, but wait a second. What about 6 o'clock? That's injected right to the iris. So let's back up for a second. If we go back, if you look, this is injected right up to the iris. This is a deep eye problem. This is not superficial. I acknowledge there's a small part of it where the limbus is clear, but the majority of it is injected. This is a problem which will show you the visual acuity as well. The visual acuity is going to be jacked up. You need to call ophthalmology and say, hey, doc, listen, I got a guy whose limbus is injected. Visual acuity is 20/100. I'm uncomfortable with this. I got to send him over to you. And no ophthalmologist in the world is going to give you pushback on this. Okay. So we have to document the limbus. So right here, the limbus is injected. Ladies and gentlemen, this is known as a ciliary flush. Ciliary flush means the injection goes right up to the iris. It's the same thing. Here's a benign eye where the limbus is clear. And here's another subconjunctival hemorrhage where the limbus is clear. So you have to understand that there are two major things we look for the eye: visual acuity and the limbus has got to be clear. All right, which was the most helpful to you? Which was the most helpful to you as a clinician? Which tool can you use the most? Which one of these would you want to teach someone at work? Would it be the pulmonary embolism, knowing that there's three things you want to always document: virtual striatum, no pleuritic chest pain, and a leg exam. Understanding that small PEs have purely pleuritic chest pain or chest wall symptoms, it's worse when they breathe. Would it be the acute coronary syndrome? Understanding the heart score, knowing that the heart score has got to be 3 or less to send them home. Understanding any objective findings, they ain't going home. But a heart score of less than 3, the chance of a major adverse negative coronary event is less than 1%. Would it be hyperkalemia? Understanding that the number one cause of hyperkalemia is always lab error till proven otherwise. And then we look at our dialysis patients, knowing that the further out from dialysis, the more risky that they are. We got to do that EKG. Looking for peak T waves, wide complex QRSs, or flat P waves. Could it be subarachnoid hemorrhage? Understanding the unbelievably important factor of acute onset. Did it come on acutely? That's the only headache that comes on acutely, guys. Now, I didn't say this before, but you really want to be mindful of what were they doing when it came on, okay? If they were lifting weights, having a bowel movement, having sex, something that would have increased intracranial pressure with a sudden onset headache, that's bad. Could it have been sepsis? Understand that the SIRS criteria is not good. It's just not a good criteria set. Understand I gave you the tool, the septic triad, which is a Johnism. It's not evidence-based. right? It's just a thinking tool of decrease urine output, increase lactic acid, increase respiratory rate. But I did give you the tool of the quick SOFA score, where they have fever, and you're looking for 2 out of 3 of the killer bees, brain, breathing, and blood pressure. We talked about appendicitis. The appendicitis and the gastroenteritis is the most common discharge diagnosis of a missed appy. And we said, what's the best test to never miss appendicitis? Time. Give them enough time, tell them. You may want to say to every single gastroenteritis you ever see for the rest of your career, I'd like you to be reevaluated in the morning. Have an abdominal pain recheck. Sick kid, tickles, the tickles mnemonic. We used a tool on how to tell between otitis media and meningitis, T-I-C-K-L-E-S, tone, irritability, consolability, cry, labor, environment, and suckling. So use them to determine that should be documented on your charts. Epiglottitis, we talked about the importance of body position. When you walk into the room, if someone has a stiff neck and turns to you, that's meningitis till proven otherwise. If you have someone who's sticking their head out, that's an upper airway obstruction consistent with epiglottitis. We then talked about suicide ideations. We talked about the importance of evaluating patients and documenting accordingly. It's as simple as no SI, no HI, no suicidal ideations, no homicidal ideations. But then we use the mnemonic sad persons. Sex, age, depression. Past attempt, E is ETUH or substance abuse. R is rational thought loss. N is no spouse, okay? O is organized plan. S is sickness. So you're looking for some of these risks that increase their probability of committing suicide. And the last one was the eye complaint. We said that there are two things you got to document for the eye, visual acuity, and that the limbus is clear. So which one of those was most helpful for you? Which one will change your practice? Which one you're going to start applying? You only get one. Like out of this Kappa lecture, you only get one of the 10. You can't use all of them. Okay, you can only use one. So which one are you going to use and embrace? Like, no, don't even think about, you know, using PE and the sick eye. No. You only get one. Okay. All right. Well, what if you applied all 10 of them? Maybe your diagnostic tools and your therapeutic interventions, maybe you'd become a better clinician if you apply all 10. But wait a second. What if it's not about learning them and applying them? What if it's about teaching them? What if you take these tools and you teach them to others? Now, if you don't precept students, you should. Okay, if you're practicing PA and you're not precepting students, let me encourage you to do this. Okay, the California Academy of PAs, all the PA schools out in California, they need preceptors. Please consider precepting a few students, because when you have a really good student, man, it enhances everything that you do. It puts you in a learning environment. Now, it's one thing to, like, do you understand, you know, when you have a nurse who's been a nurse for a while, they don't want to hear anything you have to say. Not really. Okay. But do you understand that if you teach a student in earshot of the nurses, all the nurses hear, everything gets better. So I would challenge you with this. However many preceptors you had in PA school, typically about a dozen, you owe the world 12 students. And if you're OBGYN or psych, you got to double that number, because we're really hurting in those areas. Okay, so consider taking this content, teaching it to others. These are top 10 medical emergencies that you cannot miss. To the California Academy of PAs, thank you for this opportunity to share this content. I look forward to being a speaker at future conferences. Anybody out there, please YouTube me. I have a podcast called Talk EM. I love teaching PANS, PANRI, emergency medicine, urgent care, EKG, burnout of medicine. It's my passion and calling. John Belisky from See Me for Life, our whole goal is to help you maximize your mind. Good luck. God bless.